Good morning. The song is I Can Only Imagine.
Go ahead and turn in your Bibles over to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. We've been walking the last few weeks through the book of Colossians and talking about how the where we place our hope is the most important decision we will ever make in our life. As a matter of fact, that's a message that Paul has been talking to a group of people that he's never met, helping them to understand who they are in Christ and the fact that where they place their hope is the most important decision that they will ever make in life. Paul is reminding them that God is preeminent. that God is supreme, that God is over all things. And for those of us that have received the gift of love and grace that He has so freely bestowed upon us through the death of His Son on the cross, we have a new identity. We have the ability to not only see the world in a different way, but the opportunity to live in a radically new way. One that is free of the fleshy desires that can entangle and control our lives. And when we get to chapter 3 of this amazing book, what we're going to see is that the Apostle Paul is going to take it to the next level and in a very direct and a very pointed way tell the people of Colossae where their ultimate focus needs to be, where they should have their ultimate attention centered on. So let's begin looking at verse 1. It says, "So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things of above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory." Such a beautiful expression of how we were once dead in our sins, but then Jesus came, rescued us from the bondage of death, and giving us His righteousness, placed us in a position of eternal relationship with the Father. And because of this, we can set our hearts, we can set our minds on the things from above. And there's a question that we all need to ask ourselves this morning, and that is, what is my primary focus? What captures my heart? What captures my mind more than anything else? What captures my attention? What captures my allegiance? What captures my affections more than anything else? Setting our hearts on things of God is not an escapism. It is not the kind of evacuation theology in which we can sit back and say, "Hey, I'm in Christ, I'm good, and I'm waiting on the day for Jesus to return while the world falls apart and decays." It's also not this idea of triumphalism that says that the church of Jesus Christ is going to take over everything and we're going to reign and rule here on earth. But if it's not these things, then what is it? If it's not these things, then how do we balance all of the different tensions that we can experience in our lives? The Apostle Paul gives us a perfect example, a simple idea in this text, if you will, of what our new life in Christ gives us. He says it gives us a higher sense of identity. It gives us a higher sense of allegiance, a better understanding of the fact that God is sovereign. God is in control. And we need to place our hope and our trust in Him and in Him alone. It gives us a deeper sense of trust and peace when we're living in a world that seems to have gone crazy, that seems to be off the rails a little bit. And all throughout the history of the world, people have always been looking for a leader. They've always been looking for somebody to take them into the future to help them understand this concept. And inevitably, what always happens is we put a certain level of prominence, a certain level of importance on that leader, whoever that happens to be. Back in the day, the Israelites kept asking God to give them a king like every other nation. And when you look deeper into their request, what you see, when you pull back the layers, is that you find that the request was actually revealing what they had inside, which was a flawed motivation. Because they were so focused internally and placing an importance on themselves and their personal successes rather than on the fact that they desperately, desperately needed a Savior to come and rescue them. To rescue them from themselves. In other words, they were looking so much inwardly that they weren't looking upwardly. They were looking for a worldly Savior. And sadly, this is exactly what we do in our culture today. We search for and elect new leaders. We search for and elect new presidents. And we got an election coming up within a year. And we put everything on that new leader. They will be the ones that are going to deliver us from all the evil, all the decay, all the hatred, all that we see. They're going to be the ones that are going to deliver us from that. And we search for that one, and we elect that one, and we turn to that one, and we put our hope into that one. And when that hope fails, then we're left going, who's next? Where what we should have done was put our hope with God. The people of Colossae are being reminded of that. Don't put your hope in yourselves. Don't put your hope in what's happening around you. Put your hope in God and in God alone. The book of Colossians is a reminder to us, in a culture that's decaying, in a culture that's full of looking for the next, that there will never be an elephant or a donkey that can do it. Only a sacrificial lamb. That is the only one that ever will. And so here's the question that this raises. In a toxic political and social climate that we find ourselves in, how do we as the church create an oasis? How do we create an oasis from the crazy and speak truth into the moments of life? How do we speak truth in the moments of life out of love? The first thing we need to do is to develop a prophetic presence in the world. A prophetic presence in the world. In other words, you and I are called by God to speak the truth of the gospel even when it is unpopular. Even when it is politically incorrect. We are to stand on the word of God. Not twist and turn this into something that we want it to be. We are to stand firmly on Scripture. And speak that out into a world that's trying to pick and choose. You see, Scripture tells us that the gospel is transcendent. Which means it's the lens by which we are to look at every issue that we face. And Paul is challenging the people of Colossae to look at where they are placing their identity. Where are they placing their hope? And if they're placing anything or anyone in a position of authority and supremacy in their lives other than Jesus, then their allegiance is wrong. Because he should be reigning supreme in our lives. He is the only one in control. The second thing we need to do is we need to have a prophetic distance. A prophetic distance. Meaning we can't just go along with a particular group because what they say is smooth and convincing and their argument seems to win the day. We can't go into that. We have to speak truth into it. We have to live in a distance from it, but we have to engage with it. We have to have a prophetic distance. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was a German pastor and theologian, once warned, don't sell out to power because it will corrupt the church. Don't sell out to power because it will corrupt the church. Throughout the history of the church, we've seen people divided time and time again on their views on political and social matters. Different groups selling out. And drawing lines in the sand. In Matthew chapter 16, as Jesus is talking to his disciples, he warns them to watch out and be aware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And some translations may say, watch out and be aware of the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. See, these two groups were the political powers of the time. And Jesus is saying that they will come in with their own agenda and corrupt the church by making things about themselves. And their own desires. He said there's an underlying danger in that your allegiance to a particular group or personality or even a party will erode your very witness to a world that needs to hear it. We have to be careful to keep not only a prophetic presence, but a prophetic distance. We need to speak the truth in love, but we also cannot be led astray. This is something that every one of us as believers wrestles with. How do I embody the values of kingdom and engage the culture at the same time? How do I embody the very characteristic of God who lives inside of me and embrace a culture that hates Him? How do I live my life the way God has called me to live when I'm facing Satan and his evil forces? And in verse 5, Paul answers this very dilemma by saying, here's how you conduct yourself if Christ is in you. Therefore, put to death what belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, God's wrath is coming upon the disobedient. And you once walked in these things when you were living in them. But now put away all the following: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and filthy language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old self with its practices and have put on the new. You are being renewed in knowledge according to the image of your Creator. What the Apostle Paul is communicating here by laying out this list is that our new life in Christ not only requires, but it demands a change in who we are. It not only requires, but it demands a change in who we are and how we talk and how we live our lives. And if we are truly in Christ, if God has come and saved us and freed us through the shedding of His Son's blood on the cross, if we are there, then we have to be changed. We cannot keep living in the old. He says, all this stuff that used to be present, all this stuff that used to define us, no longer exists, due to the fact that we have been purchased by the shedding of blood on the cross. And it's this simple fact that gives us the ability to live in a completely different and completely radical way as the rest of the world, that is so filled with sexual immorality, that is so filled with corruption, that is so filled with lies. The earthly church not only heard this challenge, but they accepted it and they lived by it. They took it into their heart, and by doing so, they began to transform the world around them. They began to transform the very culture that they were immersed in, because people started to take notice. People started to say, there's something different about this group of people. There's something different about the way that they approach the struggles in their life. There's something different about how they face a world that is attacking them. There's something different about the way that they celebrate. There's something different in their words, in their actions. And it's an undeniable difference. And as people take notice, people are drawn to it, because it's so attractive. And Christianity exploded during the reign of the Roman Empire, the most powerful empire that stood. Which one's standing now? Christianity is standing now. You go over to Rome, you see ruins. God's message reached out and went from region to region, area to area that was controlled by the Roman Empire. They lay in ruins, and God's message survives. Where do you want to put your hope? In the one that never fails. Look at verse 11. It says, in Christ there is not Greek, nor Jew, nor circumcision, nor uncircumcision, nor barbarian, Scythian, slave, and free, but Christ is all and in all. Paul is not being naive about the differences that exist between the different people groups. He's not being naive in thinking that there's not a class system in Rome, or that certain groups have rights while others don't. or that the Jews and the Gentiles have been at war with each other for centuries. What he's saying is this. All of this stuff that divides is nothing compared to what Jesus did in bringing us together into a family. All of these things that we focus on externally does not matter. It doesn't compare to knowing Christ. It doesn't compare to the fact that we are adopted into His family. And in His family, there is no differences. Church, our identity, the way we identify ourselves, should not be just based on race or gender or political affiliation or career or marital status, because our story is so much more. If you are in Christ, you are a child of God. Pure and simple. If you are in Christ, you are a child of God and adopted into His family first and foremost, and everything else is secondary. Being a Christian transcends every other allegiance, every other identity that we hold. And this is why we have to be so careful when we speak. This is why we have to be so careful when we say phrases like, I don't know how you can be a Christian and whatever that blank happens to be. I don't know how you can be a Christian and believe this. I don't know how you can be a Christian and believe this. Because guess what? You and I don't get to pick and choose who belongs to God's family. Only God does. Scripture tells us that He knows who we are. And He knows who's in this very diverse family that He alone has put together. What does that mean? In simple terms. That means red, yellow, black, white, Democrat, Republican, independent, male, female, rich, poor, people who have power, people who have little power. All of these groups can come together and praise God. All of these groups can come together and be one family. Think about your own family and how many diverse people are in your family. And I'm talking our family of origin. I'm talking about our extended families. But we're all one family. And the church is no different. We have people that come from all walks of life, from different backgrounds, from different experiences, with different beliefs, political and social, from different class systems, from different races, from different genders, and we all come together to praise God for what He's done. Because the family of God is not about uniformity. It's about unity in diversity. It's not about uniformity. It's about unity in diversity. But what does that look like inside of the church? What does it look like? Because this is something that a lot of us struggle with. We see something in Scripture. We see an injustice. And then we pick and choose sides and we draw lines based on what we believe that stands outside of this. And we identify our enemies. We define our enemies based on whether or not they think, look, talk, or act like us. And hear me when I say this, church, God does not draw lines like we draw lines. Instead, He is always bringing different groups of people together by challenging their convictions, by challenging their allegiances. The kingdom of God always transcends our very narrow view of this world. And that's something that as the people of God, we have to be cautious of. And Paul is actually going to give us a bit of a framework for doing this, starting in verse 12. He says, therefore, as God's chosen ones, holy and dearly loved, put on compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving one another if anyone has a grievance against another. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you are also to forgive. Above all, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity, and let the peace of Christ, to which you are also called in one body, rule your hearts, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell richly among you in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another through psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. He says we're called to be God's chosen people. We are called to be loving. We are called to be a loving family who looks past our differences, who looks past our individual opinions on things, who looks past and embraces each other in peace, humility, love, and gratitude. And this has been the very defining characteristic of the Christian church for nearly 2,000 years. This is how such a diverse group of people can come together in the most trying of times and overcome a toxic sea of anger, of hatred, and animosity that seems to be closing in and taking over the culture. It means we have to be careful what we do and especially what we say. 1 John 4:20 says, if anyone says, I love God, and yet hates his brother or sister, he is a liar. For the person who does not love his brother or sister whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And we have this command from him, the one who loves God must also love his brother and sister. Notice it doesn't say we must also love our brother and sister who thinks like us or who talks like us, who acts like us, who dresses like us. It says must love his brother or sister. Who's our brother and sister? It's anybody inside the family of God. Anybody that has accepted the message of love and grace, that has heard the gospel, that has had it let sink in, the message of Christ dying on the cross, taking that, transforming their hearts, turning and repenting from their sins and saying, God, I'm living for you. I'm a sinner and I'm turning and living for you. Anybody that has done that is part of the family of God. That's our brother and sister. We should definitely be passionate about our convictions. But we also need to be intentional by examining ourselves. The actions we are doing and the language we are using, because through them we have the power to both build up and the power to destroy. As Christians, we represent Jesus and the family of God. And we need to be focused on creating environments where God can work in and on and through the lives of those that he loves. And this is why the church exists. To minister to people of every tribe, every nation, every tongue, giving them the opportunity to hear the gospel message. There was a pastor named Fred Craddock who once described the church in this fashion. He said there was a group of friends that would gather together regularly and share a meal with each other, constantly inviting people to join them. Whenever they had somebody new join them for dinner, they had a tradition. And when the meal was done, they would all stand up in a circle and hold hands, and someone would start by saying, Hi, my name is John, and I work at the gas station on Main Street. I'm really good with fixing cars, so if you ever have any car trouble, you just call me, okay? Then the next person, Hi, my name is Teresa and I love to bake. So if you ever need a baking tip or a pie for a special occasion, you just let me know. The next person, Hi, my name is Bert. I practice law here in town. I sincerely hope you don't ever need my services. But if you do, my office is actually right next to John's gas station. They would continue to go around the circle letting everyone speak. It was a special community that had a special name. And that name was church. Let's pray.